right, let me go ahead and introduce Dr. Nan Alvarez-Gray. She began her career in nonprofit management and grant making. She completed her master's degree in counseling in 2003 and is licensed as a marriage and family therapist. She earned a doctorate in applied clinical psychology in 2014 from the Chicago School of Professional Psychology. In 2015, she earned a certificate in psychoanalytic psychotherapy from the New Center for Psychoanalysis. She is also a certified trainer of both the Love and Logic Parenting and Love and Logic Educator curriculums. She had a full-time private practice specializing in trauma for 12 years prior to joining Biola University in 2015. She is currently the coordinator of child and adolescent programs for the Biola Counseling Center. There she counsels children, adolescents, and families with a variety of presenting issues, as well as supervises doctoral students beginning to work with children, adolescents, and families. Dr. Alvarez-Gray has found that most of us bring unresolved issues from our past into our current relationships. By learning how our past relationships influence our current thoughts, feelings, and behaviors, we can have healthier relationships today. So we're going to learn a lot from her wisdom. And so this is really going to influence how we think about and how we approach our teaching and parenting roles. She and her husband are the parents of 5 grown children, and when she's not working, she enjoys drawing, sewing, swimming, and long walks with her dog. Would you help me welcome Nan?
This is a test, isn't it? To just see, like, how can we make Nan just a little more anxious? I'm drawing on all my own skills as a therapist. Just deep cleansing breath, you know. So I am here to talk with you about a topic that's near and dear to my heart, because I am not talking to you, I'm talking with you and joining you as being an overly accommodating educator. I did have my experience in teaching and homeschooling and many of the same kinds of activities. And whether I was an educator or a mother or a wife, I have a tendency to be over accommodating. I think that many of us in the Christian community do. We take scripture literally, of course, when it talks about considering one another more important than yourself. And so I'm going to talk a little bit about how some of those scriptures need to be interpreted a little bit more fully so that we are considering ourselves as well. So I have to confess that any of you who are familiar with, who's familiar with Hermione, I only read, I didn't, so you know how when you read something, you say it one way, and then you don't see the movies, and so you don't know how to pronounce it, so Hermione, thank you. Pardon?
If she teaches Victor Crumb how to say her name in book 5.
Okay, well, I'll have
it.
Well, one of the things that I advocate is self-care, especially for educators and for therapists, because we tend to not do that, and it makes us less able to serve. And I think reading book 5 is very good self-care. So, so I have to admit, this, while they say this is Hermione's cat, this is me. I even took one of those, you know, quizzes on Facebook that says, you know, which character from literature are you? And I came out Hermione. I am her. I'm bright. I love to learn. I'm excited to show people what I know. I'm eager to please. I'm bossy. And, oh, I can be annoying. And so hopefully more of the demonstrating what I want to impart to you comes across better than the bossy and the annoying part. But I was that kid in school that was like, oh, me, yeah, I know the answer. And so some of that still comes out, sadly. Because, you know, there's some parts from your past you just don't get over. It still comes out. So We're going to talk about being an overly accommodating educator or an overly accommodating teacher. I don't use those words synonymously because some of you here are teachers in the classroom. All of you are educators in one way or another, so I'll use those both of those terms, but I'm meaning to include everyone here in the room. So and me. So some warning signs, some things that we see in folks that are overly accommodating. And I want to clarify at the beginning, overly accommodating can sometimes be called codependent. And I'm not talking about codependency. Codependency has a negative feel to it. It has a pathological feel to it. No one wants to be labeled codependent. And I'm coming more from a positive psychology perspective where we're looking at ways in which we overly accommodate, but we're not sick people. You know, we don't all need to go into therapy in order to recover from our being overly accommodating. We need to think about it and talk about it and see how it applies to us. So just to clarify, we have, and I'm going to be using we a lot, we have a tendency to be indirect. We have difficulty asserting ourselves when we have a need. Sometimes we even have trouble noticing that we have a need. We have a hard time playing. When I was writing my bio for June, it's like, now what do I do for fun? All right. It's hard to, sometimes I just take life seriously. And my mom even talks about that I was born taking life seriously. And she thinks I should play more. Well, she's right. Playing is rough. It just doesn't come naturally to me. I'm a serious, important Hermione, show you what I know person. So we justify others' inappropriate behavior rather than confronting. We'll find a reason why, maybe that's okay. So excessive loyalty, no matter what the cost. We will stick with someone, we will stick with a relationship, no matter how it might be harming us or harming them, because we have this high value of loyalty. It's hard to ask for help. And tend to be perfectionists. So some of us may kind of align with a few of these. Some warning signs continued are feel responsible for another person's behavior, feelings, or problems. As teachers and as mothers and as Christian men and women, we are responsible to other people. That's a scriptural principle. We're responsible to serve. We're responsible to help. It's a matter of when it crosses that. Am I still just using this mic? Yeah, okay. So I can't move. It's a matter of when it crosses that line, it becomes, I'm responsible for that person. And we're not responsible for other people. We're responsible for ourselves, and we're responsible to other people. Sometimes we'll base our self-esteem or our self-worth not on what God thinks of us or even on our own accomplishments and what we've done. We'll base it on what other people think of us. So we always need that other person to think well of us. we will feel angry, guilty, or resentful when our help isn't effective or acknowledged. We need both. And my definition of resentment, which I will use on and off, was given to me by my daughter, but I know she didn't make it up. But resentment, an emotion we're all familiar with, I'm sure. If you're not, wow, help me. it's drinking poison and hoping the other person dies. So it's not an effective way to deal with conflict through resentment. We want to avoid that. And so the next one is experiencing anger about injustices done to others is much more easy than experiencing anger about injustices done to ourselves. I will notice because I did work in private practice with trauma victims so much that trauma usually means that there's been some sort of really life-altering event or events in their usually childhood is what I would deal with, but or in their adulthood. And so if I had, say, a victim of sexual abuse, she would very easily identify with people in the news, people in the media, friends, other people maybe in a support group who had been abused, and be angry and righteously angry on their behalf, but have a lot of trouble being angry on her own behalf. So we can look at maybe our fellow teachers, and there's a parent that's not treating them respectfully and be really upset on their behalf. But when we're treated the same way, like, well, you know, sometimes I wonder, maybe I deserve that. Maybe that's just how life goes for me. So our good feelings, they tend to stem from being liked by you. I pathologically need to be liked. That's where the pathology comes in. the good feelings about who we are stem from receiving your approval. So I'll even notice, especially being new to my position, and I'll want to know, am I doing a good job? Is Dr. Taylor pleased with me? And I have to watch myself that I'm not looking to her to say, weekly or more often, good job, Nan, that's just what I wanted you to do, because certainly that's not appropriate. You know, getting appropriate kudos is there. But I have to watch myself that I'm not looking to get more appreciation than really is typical, necessary, appropriate for a business relationship. Time is spent on your hobbies, not yours, but your loved ones. So instead of enjoying sewing, you go to visit train depots with your husband. Or that's just the best example I could think of off the top of my head. But we tend to, instead of saying what we want to do, we tend to ask, what do you want to do? And we participate in that. And often that's out of a fear of someone else's anger or disappointment. And so we let that determine what we're going to do. Okay? Is this making sense so far? I see a lot of nodding heads. Please, we're a small enough group that if you have questions or comments, please raise your hand. I would, I do better with a little bit of back and forth, having taught for a while, and I'm glad that we have a group size such that that can happen. So don't hesitate. Now, what about I? We've talked a lot about how we are in relation to other people. What about who I am, who we are? I am not aware of how I feel when I'm overly accommodating. I am aware of how you feel, or at least how I believe you feel. I am not aware of what I want when I'm being overly accommodating. I'm aware of what you want, or at least what I believe you want. And that's where some of the difficulty comes in. I'm then deciding or intuiting what you need, what you feel, what you want, and not necessarily checking to see if I'm even accurate. We use giving, and I mean we use giving, or I, even if all of you say, I'm not overly accommodating, I can't relate to this at all, I'll have to come before you and confess, I am. So I use giving as a way to feel safe in relationships. And I don't, that can mean giving gifts, that can mean giving time, that can mean giving a bunch of different types of things, but it makes me feel safe because then I have some measure of control and doing that. So when I read that while I was researching for this talk, I was really curious about it because we all know Chapman's work on the five love languages, and one of them is gift giving, right? And I've always said my love language is gift giving. I mean, I'm delighted with a pack of Juicy Fruit gum. Anything makes me happy. Just think of me while you're away, and that makes me happy. I'll have to tell you, I don't know the answer of how gift giving as a love language coincides with giving in order to feel safe in a relationship. I know that there's room for difference there, but I haven't fully teased that out. So I don't want to pretend to be the expert that I'm not. Yes, ma'am. Absolutely.
And calls us to think of others first. So the things that you're listing, I don't find offensive, nor degrading. I find them biblical. So I'm confused as to why you're listing them. Is these an exaggeration? Are these something that are biblical? Why are these being listed? I mean, of course, we could go through each one.
Right.
Well,
it becomes when we do these things and lose who we are. Because Scripture talks about, consider one another more important than yourself. It has a core meaning that you already consider yourself important. Otherwise, it would just say, consider one another important. And so there's this assumption that you consider yourself important as well. Love one another as you love yourself. An assumption that you love yourself already. And what happens, and what I'm talking about, is we have lost ourselves. And we are, the giving, the sacrificial nature of what we do has come to such an extent that we no longer have a personhood. And we are giving up what we want at all times and not allowing the other person to be responsible for their own life as well. And I may be, and I'm certainly known to do this, so intent on understanding what you mean, what you feel, what you want to do, that I don't even respect you having the opportunity to say, this is what I mean, this is what I feel, this is what I do. I take that responsibility away from you. And so it's not necessarily that it's to a greater degree as much as it is intent behind it. And have we lost ourselves? So, I have little children's songs that go on in my head because I sang to my kids so much, and so they still come into my head. And one is what that I sang continually, that I will spare you and not. No. what was about teaching my children to have a servant's heart, and. I am in no way suggesting that a servant's heart is not the biblical and the right place for us to land. It's just, is that happening in exclusion of you taking care of yourself? Does that answer your question?
It does.
Good. Thank you for bringing that question up, because it comes up often, especially with Christians who are like, but I thought I was supposed to serve. And yes, ma'am, you are. So we use our giving as a way to feel safe in a relationship. A lot of these activities or ways of being have come up. As Dr. Hetzel said, I have a core belief that who we are in relationships today is related to how we did relationships, or relationships were done with us when we were children. And so we kind of develop this mold and we live according to that mold. And so So some of us grew up with one or all or a few of rules like this, or some that some others that are similar. The first is do, be strong, good, right, and perfect. You know, there's very few parents out there that tell their children to be perfect. I've not met one, and I've worked with a lot of parents. But there's an underlying message. Do make me proud. Now, of course, we want our children to make us proud. That's a natural experience. We want our children to want to care about how we feel. But it's a matter of, you make me proud so I look good. Not, you make me proud so that you have the capacity to feel good about something you do. I have this expression I use with my children and some of the students that I work with as well, that when they really accomplish something spectacular, and I want them, my daughter just gave a conference in Prague. Okay, see, now that's spectacular. She's something. And I want her to know that I'm proud of her, but I want her to own the success, not me, even though I just bragged about it. And so I will say to her, Ellen, you know that good feeling you have right now? You earned it. And it's her success, not mine. And I get to enjoy with her, but not enjoy for her. Okay? So that's where I talk about folks who make me feel good about myself. Be a well-behaved child so that I don't have to worry about what other people are thinking or feeling or judging me. Don't make me look bad. I had one unfortunate situation as a therapist, and there a dad had gone to a pool party with his company, and there was some sibling issues going on, and the two sisters were literally in the pool trying to drown each other. Then this is not good. This has gone beyond sibling rivalry. This is a bad situation. And the father was so humiliated that this had happened in front of all of his colleagues that it became about them embarrassing their dad instead of what in the world is going on that they want to kill each other. And so he was caught up in looking bad. Another rule that we may have from childhood is don't have too many needs. Don't overwhelm me with the number of needs that you have. And often don't be a child. You know, we do train our children not to be childish. We want them to grow up and make important, developmentally appropriate decisions. But we need to delight in their childlikeness. And how they sometimes are just magic in the way they interact with each other and themselves. And I love to just sit and observe children that don't know they're being observed. It's delightful. So those childhood rules become adult rules. And some of the rules that we may live by is it's not okay for me to have problems. I need to have it all together. I see some of you taking notes so furiously. I'm sorry. Would it be helpful if I give you this PowerPoint so that you... Oh, okay. Okay. You know, I do too. And do you know why that is? Yeah, I'd be happy to give you the PowerPoint so that you can distribute it. But do you know why that is? I need to do the same thing. You learn visually, auditorily, or kinesthetically. I'm a kinesthetic learner, so I don't even necessarily have to return to my notes, but I need to write them down. Exactly. So
I'm getting all three right now.
Yeah. Good. Good. I'm glad. So, but that is for those of us who always need to write something down, and you know, no one else in the congregation is taking notes to the sermon, but you are, you know, and you have all the notes in the side of your Bible and those kinds of things. That's, again, I can join you in that. There's such an atmosphere of joining here today. So it's not okay to have problems. It's not okay to have fun, because we should be serious and be looking after more important things. I'm not lovable as I am. I'm not good enough, and I must try harder. Boy, that's one that a lot of us really identify with. I'm not good enough. I'm not likable, but everyone needs to like me. And boy, are you stuck there, you know. So just coming back to the characteristics, and then we'll move on to another part of this talk. We often have an exaggerated sense of responsibility for the actions for others. And that's where I talk about being responsible for someone else. You know, even as a teacher, you have to send, you know, Johnny up to the principal of the school or the lead administrator in the school more often than all of your fellow teachers need to send a student up. And it feels like I need to get Johnny to behave so that I don't stand out as a teacher who can't control one of my students. We have a tendency to do more than our fair share all the time. doing more than our fair share comes with the territory sometimes, doesn't it? Because people are sick, people go on vacation, we all have limitations of what we're able to do, and we can't all perform at the same level all the time. But it's when we're continually doing more than our fair share. We're continually the one that can be counted on to stay late, to work late, to overproduce, that it becomes difficult. We have a tendency to be hurt when our efforts aren't recognized. When no one says, when we do work late and no one says, wow, did you notice that Nan, you know, went beyond and you know, she's only a half-time employee, which I am a half-time employee, and look at all of the extra things she's doing right now. And I need to have within myself that I am doing the efforts that I feel are appropriate to my position and that I'm not doing them in order to receive outside recognition. And I want to really be clear about this because some of us supervise and all of us are with young children. Recognition and praise is vital to both those you supervise and to young children. So I'm not in any way saying that that shouldn't be part of your moment-by-moment interactions, especially with children. It's a matter of when that goes to an extreme. And so it comes back to your question of when things go to an extreme as opposed to when things are in more balance. We have an extreme need for approval and for recognition. And when we assert ourselves, we often feel guilty. And oddly enough, with as much as those of us who are overly accommodating seem to know, especially those of us who are, you know, like the cat, we have difficulty making decisions. And why is that? Because we're trying to please everyone all the time. And so how can I know which is the right decision to make? Well, will this faction be happy? Will this faction be happy? What about these folks over here? And then when all else fails, at least my kids need to be happy. And so we're always trying to make everyone else happy, which makes making a decision really difficult. So I've told you a lot about what overly accommodating looks like. And so I come up with these, what I call the $100,000 questions that you can ask yourself based on the information I just gave you. The first one is, do I think I'm responsible for the thoughts and actions of others? Do I often feel hurt or resentful? Do other people control me? Do I have an overwhelming need for others to like me? Do I give up my own interests in order to please others? Do I need to feel needed? And do I feel more secure when I receive praise from others? I'm not suggesting you need to answer yes to all of those in order to say, wow, I really do have some tendencies towards overly accommodating. But perhaps you may say yes to one or two of them. And what I can say next is, there's hope for us. We don't have to live this way. We don't have to live in a place where we are constantly trying to please someone else. I remember there's an expression that every good therapist has had a good therapist, because if you're a therapist and you've never been in therapy, really, why? So I had a good therapist many years ago, and I walked into her office one day and I said, you know, Susan, I think I'm a people pleaser. She just busted up laughing. She thought it was the funniest thing she'd ever heard because I had come up with something that was so very obvious. Of course I was a people pleaser. She had known that from day one when she first met me, but it had taken well over a year into counseling for me to recognize, ah, I'm a people pleaser, huh? So sometimes I'm not fast and not quick. So the first thing we're going to talk about is the idea of boundaries. One of the beginning things we need to do in order to help, in order to stop being an overly accommodating woman, overly accommodating man, overly accommodating teacher, is to have some boundaries. Boundaries include our personal space. We've all been, you know, in the market, and someone gets way closer to you than you wish they would, and they're in your personal space. So you can think of that personal space physically as being a psychological experience. So we need to press the, we need to have these limits in order to protect ourselves. These limits include, what am I willing to accept? What behavior am I willing to accept? What behavior am I willing to tolerate? What am I willing to believe? I love this one, especially when we work with young children who, I don't know if this has been your experience, but it's been mine, where I will, well, my child's kindergarten teacher, and someone repeated this to me the other day, my child's kindergarten teacher said, if you only believe half of what he tells me about you, I'll only believe half of what he tells you about me. You know, children, sometimes it's just in their childlikeness that they will misinterpret things. And sometimes, you know, I don't know, maybe you've never noticed it, children can be manipulative. Anyone ever seen that before? So just what are we going to believe from our students? I did my homework and the dog ate it. And this, I think, comes out, this came out in a couple of our meetings, comes out a lot when there are missing assignments and there's this note that needs to go home. Yeah, laughter over here. It's like, this note really does need to go home. It really is in your student's best interests. And it really does come up to, what are you going to tolerate with your student? Are you going to accept this behavior? Are you going to believe that you might be manipulated just a little bit there? So, and it also includes what we are willing to do. So it includes what we're willing to accept, what we're willing to tolerate, what we're willing to believe, and what we're willing to do, all come up into what makes up our boundaries. It defines where my problem ends and your problem begins. Okay, we've all heard the expression, an emergency on your part doesn't necessitate an emergency on my part. So we're going to talk now for a minute about types of relationships. And I have to... I won't pull it any further. So what you see here is my collection of Beanie Babies. This is... we saved these for our children's college educations. And intended to pay for them. With them, that didn't work out very well. But they've all graduated from college now, so I'm good. So now I get to just use them in my office. I use these a lot with young people. I have a big mat that's got little squares in them, and I'll ask them to assign a Beanie Baby to a person, and then I want to see how close or far away the individual people are. So we talk about there being disengaged people. And so here we have our purple thing, and he's here, and then this guy maybe isn't even looking on, and this guy's over here, and these two might even be like this, but they're not facing each other. And so these are my disengaged family or my disengaged system. This system right here, we'll just kind of move over here. This is my enmeshed system. These people all are way too much in each other's business. And they can't make decisions on their own. They can't operate independently. They are dependent on each other. Then in the middle, what we have are the folks that are interdependent. And so they can form a circle and sometimes even have to step away because they go somewhere else, but they can all be part of a group together. And so when we are talking about difficulties with boundaries, we could be talking about this group over here that's disengaged, and they just don't even really care about each other very much. They're all very independent. Or we may be talking about this group over here
which you can't even tell where one ends and the other begins, and they're enmeshed, and they're caught up in each other. What we say, caught up in each other's business, you know. And then we have, and so they're dependent. And what we have in the middle is interdependence. And folks that they need each other. You know, these two folks, I think they might even be married. Yeah, and this is their son. and they need each other, but grandma over here doesn't necessarily come in and come in between. She has her own place. Maybe she even lives with them, but it's not right up in their business. And so this is what we call a healthy relationship. So can you see what I'm talking about when I say disengaged, enmeshed, or healthy? And so we're looking to develop healthy relationships where, so as further definition, the disengaged, we would call that the disengaged I. And what we have here is minimal closeness, high independence, too many boundaries. You know, there's a wall here that goes about this high, and then there's another wall here that goes this high, and then there's a stream that goes down the middle, and no one can even communicate with each other. And there's minimum interest and minimum involvement in each other's lives. Okay? What we have over here with our enmeshed we have fluid boundaries. So it's think of it like a pond that the water moves not swiftly like a river might, but the water does move. There's excessive closeness and high dependence. This person can't decide what to wear to work without emailing it to this person, who then says, well, what about this? And then this person makes another decision. And don't get me wrong, I email my outfits to my best friend all the time. So I'm not saying that doesn't happen. It's a matter of not being able to make those decisions. There's few boundaries. There's excessive interest and involvement in this family. And like I said, they're in each other's business. So we don't want to do that. And the healthy, we call this an I and a we. So that we have an I, we have an individual, as a personhood, and we have a we. And neither one is sacrificed at the expense of the other. We have intact but flexible boundaries. Sometimes we say, you know, no, that can't happen. And sometimes there's extenuating circumstances that allow us to flex with our boundaries. There's no flexibility over here, okay? Separation. There is separation and there is connection. And this is an interesting point. If I were talking to a group of parents, I might be talking about this a little bit differently, in that we have separation and connection with our kids, but generally we're very close to them. Here we're talking about a professional relationship. And so there needs to be that appropriate separateness because these are people you work with. And yet there needs to be an appropriate connection, in part because we're part of the same family of Christ. And then in part because that connection allows for better teaching for their student. We call this interdependence, and there's a balance of being together and being alone. You know, this, isn't that cute? This ladybug is not afraid to be alone, and her dinosaur friend isn't threatened when she's alone, but they enjoy spending time together. Okay, so there's a balance there. And there's a tolerance for differences. You know, here, the two dogs are the ones that had to get together here, even though they're not really together. But here we have a large kind of menagerie of families that are different. And so that means tolerating differences in denominations, tolerating differences in ways of being, tolerating differences in hobbies and interests. That doesn't mean tolerating differences in does your child get their schoolwork done. Okay, it doesn't, that's where we come back to a boundary. And they are all supportive and respectful. Okay, so this is my enmeshed family and my disengaged family. Now all of us come from a family of origin that fits really in one of those three categories. not distinctly, you know, there was movement from one to the other, but we will do what we're most comfortable with. So if we came from a disengaged family, we will tend to be more disengaged in our relationships. If we came from an enmeshed family, we will tend to be more enmeshed in our relationships. And so it's something to be aware of in ourselves. So a lot of the idea of being an overly accommodating educator comes to needing to know ourselves pretty well. Now let's talk a little bit about boundaries in Biola Youth Academics. There could be some difficulty saying no. You know, a parent comes and asks you to do something, asks you to excuse an assignment, and it's the third one that semester, and you have to say no. And what are we afraid of? There's some realistic fears. What are we afraid of when we're afraid of saying no? Can someone help me? That they'll leave the program, absolutely. What else? They will yell at you in front of everybody, and you know, I hate to tell you, but that's not an entirely unreasonable fear. You know, sometimes we do have parents that go over the top, and we are afraid of that, and it's embarrassing, and it's hard to deal with, and you're a new teacher, and so it's even harder to deal with. So they'll leave the program, that they'll get upset in front of other people. Anything else? The student won't like me anymore. Yeah, and we really want the students to like us, and honestly, they'll do better if they like us. But we do get afraid that the student won't like us.
Yeah. Well, there is a stigma within the homeschooling community, but it is a very small community, and when parents take a class and you have a reputation, sometimes it can get a little hard to say no, because you know that out there, and people are taking classes because it's you,
right?
And yet you're the one that's saying no,
right?
So at some point, it can get a little sticky.
And if you were the teacher that said no all the time, they might not take your class,
which I am, and it's actually worked out great.
There you go. All right, stand up, we'll applaud. But the homeschooling community is very small, and then within Biola Youth, it's even smaller. And so we do get concerned of, if I tell this person no, how's that going to go over with all of the people they talk to? And we will get talked about that in a little bit some more. Over here.
I'm just going to say it's the rumors that get passed around.
Yeah.
Mrs. Smith said that Johnny couldn't turn in his homework, and she is so mean and unreasonable, and they don't know that, you know, Johnny comes to class, doesn't pay any attention, that mom is taking him on 4 field trips a week and not doing the schoolwork that's assigned. They don't know the full story. I run into that actually as a therapist, and I'm sure you run into it as a teacher, that people can go out there and say anything they want about me, but everything they say to me is confidential. I can't say any, I can't tell my side of the story to anyone. And you're in the same boat. You know, you need to hold what's happening with your students confidentially. And so when people are saying, boy, is she mean, you can't come back. Now let me straighten that out. It didn't really go that way. You can't do that. And so this comes again to being okay with who we are and the decisions that we've made. Setting and maintaining healthy boundaries. The first thing we want to do in having healthy boundaries is we need to have a clear sense and identity of who we are and what our role is. So let's come back to who we are in Christ, first of all and foremost. Let's then come back to who we are and our characteristics. Like, I identify as Hermione's. Hermione! You know, can you take that part out? I identify as Hermione's cat. I recognize that I am that. Oh, pick me. And also tend to be bossy and a little overbearing. I know myself that way. And I honestly have learned to find it delightful. Instead of, oh, there I am again, bossing someone around. So I am careful not to boss too much, though. We need to develop limits about what you can do. You know, I need 9 hours of sleep. I just do. That's more than most people need. But I need 9 hours of sleep. And when my husband is like, you're going to bed, it's 9. I'm like, I'm getting up tomorrow at 6. I Got to go to bed. So that's a limit that I have. But then also know the limits of what you can do where you might become resentful or frustrated. You know, if I give Johnny one more chance, I'm going to become resentful of him or his mother. Okay. And then the other thing to, in terms of setting and maintaining healthy boundaries, is empowering others so that their problem doesn't become our problem. That's where I am, my problem is, and their problem is. So they're having a problem. I don't take it in as my need to solve it. I empower them to solve it themselves. And one of my favorite questions is, do you know what others in your situation have tried? Or do you want to know what others in your situation have tried? I'm not telling them what to do, but I'm helping them, because honestly, if they had a bunch of options in mind, they wouldn't be coming to you. That wouldn't be necessary. So they need some help developing these options. So when I ask, do you want to know what others in your situation have tried, I'm giving them options and empowering them, as opposed to, you should do this. Okay? Now, the other part, though, of having a healthy sense of who we are and not being overly accommodating, is taking very good care of ourselves. I frequently will leave meetings, whether it's with clients or friends or coworkers, with the expression, take good care. It's very important to me that the people I know and love take good care of themselves. And I had the opportunity when I was a doctoral student to write a dissertation on how do we measure wellness? What does being a well person look like? We usually think of wellness as being nutrition and exercise. But really the research has shown that wellness is much broader than that. And I then went and said, and what kind of wellness do we see in psychotherapists? And it would be very interesting to see what kind of wellness we see in teachers as well, because there's a lot of overlap between psychotherapists and teachers. So here's the research-based issues that come about in being a well person. They think, so this was key for me this morning, as I was thinking, I am terrified of making this talk, and I am scared, and I don't know what happened, and I had to consciously take my thoughts captive and say, yes, I'm anxious. If I weren't anxious, I'm not taking it seriously, but I am not going to obsess on how scared I am, okay? It involves emotions. Are we aware of our emotions and what we're feeling? It involves having a sense of control in our lives. It involves having a healthy work life. It involves laughter and play, a healthy way of managing stress, having a personal identity that we can really connect with. It involves realistic beliefs about what might happen in the future. It involves having loving relationships and an active spirituality that's part of your life. It involves identifying culturally. You know, who am I as an Irish American? And what parts of my history come back directly from Ireland? You can tell from my skin alone that I'm Irish American, because it's, my mom calls it the cheap Irish skin. You know, I turn red and get blotches and all those kinds of things. But I strongly identify as Irish, and it's important to me. And if you look at my last name, Alvarez-Gray, my husband strongly identifies as Mexican. So how embarrassing that my phone just went off. But it's off. I'm not good with the electronics. And then, of course, we need to add in exercise and nutrition, because those are important parts of who we are. But one of the things that I wanted to end this particular talk with today is the idea of play. That we need to, and I need a couple people down here to help me. We need. Like three or four? That we need to have, and it's not just that this is something extra that we add. We need to have a sense of play. in our lives. So it's one of the...
We are handing them out.
One of the things I like to do... You want to take the bag? Oh, look at you. You are awesome. One of the things I like to do when I speak is I like to leave you with a little something so that when you have that on your desk or you have that in your home or whatever you choose to do with it, you can remember some of what I said, hopefully. So I leave you with these pinwheels, which are one of my favorite things. And please enjoy them now. You don't need to wait to play. We're going to specialize in play today. So enjoy these and remember to set some time aside in your attempts to not be an overly accommodating educator, to have some time to play. To follow up on our last session, there were just a few questions that one member asked that it was like, wow, those really fit with specifically with Biola youth instructors. The one question that you can ask yourself, are you comfortable asking for direction or for help? Are you okay if a lesson failed? Are you okay with a parent or student not liking you? Are you comfortable with who you are? Are you trying to be the student's friend or teacher? Are you working for the Lord or for others' praise? And I mean in an extreme way. Do you have this inner critic that's always needing to be quieted? Are you generous with praise and generous with kindness? Or is there part of you that is a little manipulative with your praise or your kindness? I have to admit to that sometimes. Are you comfortable maintaining due dates with students and maintaining those boundaries with their students? With your students. So there's some kind of follow-up questions that you can be asking yourself, especially as we take this lesson back home specifically to you as a Biola youth employee. Okay? What we're going to talk about now is managing difficult situations, because actually, back up a second, back up the bus. I wanted to stop and see if there are any questions after our last session together, of any that come up or comments, anything before we move on? Yes, ma'am.
I just wanted to encourage, I've been homeschooling over 20 years, and I wanted to encourage all the teachers to realize that they are actually the partnership with the parents. Mm-hmm. We are not the all-inclusive teachers.
Right.
And so actually it's kind of a double relationship that's being formed there with the student and with the parent in a more concentrated effort than as if it was a private or a public school, because there is more of the shouldering of the responsibility on a private or a public school situation. But for us, the responsibility really should not lay on our shoulders completely. We are partnering with the parent and mentoring. So it would be wonderful if the parents could come and stand up on this kind of thing as well, because they need the encouragement to not let their kids take advantage of them. We do realize that when an assignment is being made, it is the parent's responsibility to help their students understand their responsibility. So we are partnering with them.
Right. Yeah, the idea that we're partners with the parents and are not solely responsible for this child's education. There's actually someone who's even more primarily responsible than we are, and that is the parent who is homeschooling. Thank you. Did I get that right? Okay, good. I just like to be sure. Anyone else?
You said that if I wasn't stressed, I would be taking this seriously, but I'm not going to obsess over that, and I love that. So how do you maintain the balance between stressing, like healthy non-stress, and then obsessed non-stress?
Well, here's what I do. Sometimes this is embarrassing, but here's what I do when I notice that I'm really obsessing over something, and it's called thought stopping. And because I was doing my obsessive thing of being scared of being here. And so I said, okay, that's not healthy for me to keep thinking about that. So what I do in my mind is I literally imagine a stop sign, you know, I don't know what shape it is, but you're all teachers, so you know. the octagon and the red and the stop. So I get this obsessive, I'm scared. I see the stop sign. Oh, okay, I'm not going to be scared right now. I'm going to take my thoughts captive. Then I turn it around and I envision something good. And so what I was envisioning instead was all of the benefit that might happen from here and how much I would actually, because this is fun for me once I get in my groove. And so I turned it around and took that thought captive and turned it into what would be fun about doing this. And you can use thought stopping in a large variety of ways, but it works really good with anxiety. So is that helpful? Oh, good. Good.
That's actually very relevant when we have to go into a probation meeting or confront a student about work. Thank you for that.
You're welcome. Yeah, thought stopping is a great thing to have in our back pocket because Scripture is very clear about taking thoughts captive, but then it's like, well, but how do I do that? And so that's how I do it. Anyone else?
I wanted to add in response to this last question, which I thought was such a great question, that asking what is the worst case scenario, the lesson can fail. Would that be the end of the world? No. You'll have another lesson the next day. You know. So that's a strategy that I use.
That's
and then
good.
Sometimes I will just say, oh, I really could use 60 minutes prepare. I have 30 minutes prepare. Well, whatever happens in that time is what happens. Mm-hmm. And then I would just go and let the Lord bless that time.
Amen.
And just give it to him in prayer and just ask for his peace.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. And the peace suppresses all understanding. So. All right, what we're going to talk about now is managing difficult situations. And you can see how, for those of us who might identify as an overly accommodating educator, might have more trouble managing difficult situations. So we're going to talk about that for a little bit. Someone mentioned this earlier. Mary, I think it was you who met Mary, right? Yeah. Who mentioned that we partner with parents. You know, we're not the only educator. And the thing that I have been most impressed with in my meetings to prepare for today's talk is the multiplicity of relationships that exist here at Biola Youth Academy, academics. So if I get, and I'm sure this isn't even all of them, but you have multiple complex relationships with campus coordinators, office administrators, instructors and teachers, parents, students. Who am I missing? Church staff. What else? Study hall supervisors, teaching assistants. All of those people are all part of your Biola Youth Academics staff that you have direct contact with, and there is the potential to have a difficult relationship with any of them. And so being that you spread out into so many types of relationships, difficult relationships are going to be something that need to be carefully thought through and made a priority, because healthy relationships are our priority, no matter whether we're dealing with students, parents, instructors, office, whether we're dealing with the dean. Whoever we're working with, having a healthy relationship is the priority. So it all starts with discomfort when there's a misunderstanding. It starts with discomfort. That feeling inside that things aren't right. Sometimes it's difficult to identify what the problem is, but we know there is one. So from discomfort, we go to an incident, just a little incident. There's a sharp exchange that occurs, but there's no lasting internal reaction. Maybe we're mildly upset or irritated for a moment, but we're able to let it go. Then we go to having a full-on misunderstanding between two people or three or more, and we see a lack of communication going on. And also in that misunderstanding, perhaps we're not seen in, an understanding that relationships are our priority and that resolving the conflict is a priority. Next, we find that the discomfort, the incident, the misunderstanding has resulted in tension. And tension, the relationship feels weighed down by negative attitudes and fixed opinions. This is what I think, and it's the right way. The relationship becomes, at this point, a source of worry. And then lastly, what I termed a crisis, which perhaps crisis isn't quite the right word, this is when our behavior is affected and normal functioning is difficult, and this is where rupture takes place, is in the crisis. So that's what I was calling crisis, is that there's a rupture in relationship. The parent leaves, the good staff member quits, something happens and the relationship ruptures. So we're going to talk about how we can deal with this cycle or these levels of increasing difficulty in relationships. So the first thing we need to talk about is conflict. Conflict is normal. It happens in every relationship. If you don't have conflict, you're dead. But the other part is conflict is part of a healthy relationship. I remember a good friend of mine, this was such a good example. She had planted some impatience by her front door. And every time she walked out, she complained that they were getting too much water, too much sun, they grew too tall, that something was wrong with them. And finally her husband said to her, "You know, Barb, you complain about that every time. And it's getting hard to listen to." And so what that did for Barb was so good because it increased her sense of safety in the relationship. Because, because when there was something that her husband had to say, she knew he would say it. She didn't have to be wondering what he was thinking. And so there was an opportunity for conflict and a little bit of a conflict and misunderstanding, and they resolved it and she worked on it and she felt safer in the relationship as a result. Okay. So we need to learn to deal with conflict straight on rather than avoid it, and that it needs to be handled in a respectful, positive way that in the end actually strengthens the bond we have with others instead of it being weakened. That sounds pretty much impossible sometimes, doesn't it? And yet it's not. It really isn't. So, conflict 101. A conflict is more than just a disagreement, okay? We can disagree and agree to disagree, and that is simply disagreement. A conflict is when sometimes it's taken personally, sometimes one person won't flex. The conflict takes it deeper. Conflicts, it's a situation in which both parties perceive a threat, whether it's real or not. Okay, so that's how I differentiate it from being a disagreement. Both parties feel a threat, whether there is one or not. Okay, conflicts continue to fester when they're ignored. Perceived threats interfere with our well-being and will stay with us until they're resolved. The perceived threat will interfere with our well-being and how we feel as a person until it's resolved in one way or another. We respond to conflicts based on our perceptions, not necessarily our objective perceptions. We don't necessarily respond to conflicts based on facts. We may base it on life experience, culture, values, or beliefs. Conflicts trigger strong emotions. If you have trouble tolerating strong emotions or managing your emotions, it's going to be even more difficult to resolve. The other part of that is conflicts trigger strong emotions sometimes that are completely unrelated to the situation. And if I'm having a discussion with my very good friend, Michelle Willingham, and we're having a conflict, I will share with her some of what's going on for me internally, even from my past, as to why that conflict is feeling so difficult for me at the time. But if I'm having a conversation with June, I'm probably not going to do that because it's not professional and it's not the nature of our relationship. And so we have to, if I'm having a conversation with a coworker, I might share one thing. If I'm having a conversation with a dean, I'm probably going to share something else. If I'm having a conversation with a parent, I'm going to share one thing. And if I'm having a conversation with my husband, I'm going to share something else. And so it's very important that what is triggered and how much of that is shared is dependent on the relationship, and that we're maintaining our good boundaries that we talked about with the parents and the children and our coworkers, and realizing that because of the complexity of the relationships at BYA, you're going to have different boundaries and you're going to share different triggers with different people. Does that make sense? Okay, good. Conflicts are an opportunity for growth. The reason conflicts are an opportunity for growth is that when a conflict is resolved, it builds trust. It builds trust in the relationship, and it builds trust in each other that you're both willing to keep going that extra mile to resolve the conflict. Okay? Relationships can survive. We learn that relationships can survive challenges and disagreements, and so we have more trust in our relationship surviving. Does that make sense? Good. Now, conflicts, in my experience, often aren't about or only about the situation that's right in front of me. Conflicts can trigger strong internal feelings. They can trigger our need to feel safe. Like my friend Barb, who felt safe with her husband when he said, "Yeah, you complain about those impatiens every day." That increased her ability to feel safe, and she needed to feel safe in her marriage. They can trigger feelings regarding needing to feel secure, feel respected and valued. We can have a need for greater closeness. And so we don't necessarily have to share every one of these needs, but we need to be aware of them internally and recognize that we have our own deeper needs that need to be met there. That doesn't mean that with each person we're saying, you know, well, I was speaking with my therapist and she said, you doesn't have to go there, but it can go there internally, okay? And with some relationships, it does need to go there. We can't hold that to ourselves all the time. And then lastly, we need to recognize the legitimacy of conflicting needs. One person's need to be respected may conflict with another person's need to feel safe. And that conflicting need needs to be respected, okay? And so, like I said, it's good to recognize what's going on internally and also that it's not always appropriate to share. Now, we're going to talk about... Does this slide come out okay? Can you see it okay? Good. These are different ways of managing conflicts, and they're pretty obvious. Unhealthy, we have an inability to recognize and respond to what matters most to the other person. And in a healthy managing conflict, we have the capacity to recognize and respond to things that matter to the other person. Unhealthy can get explosive, angry, hurtful, or resentful, because resentment is really just explosions happening internally. Or healthy, calm, non-defensive, and respectful. And unhealthy, we'll see a withdrawal of relationship, which results in rejection, isolation, shaming, abandonment. And in healthy, we see a readiness to forgive without resentment and anger. So there's this a continual being ready to forgive, but without a sense of, but I'm going to remember that, you know, and I'm going to hold that against you next time. We have an inability to compromise in unhealthy and an ability to compromise without being punishing. So it's, I'll give you this, but then you owe me one. There's unhealthy, we have a fear and avoidance of conflict, and in healthy, facing conflict is both best for both sides. Now we're not saying conflict's fun, go after it, boy, is it great. But the resolution of conflict is excellent for your relationships. Now, some helpful responses. Oh, hold on. I missed a whole part of my notes. There's four abilities that you need to have in order to be able to manage conflict successfully. This, I don't have a slide for this. The first is that you need to be able to manage stress quickly while remaining calm. Accurately and read and interpret. So for those of us that, you know, stress comes and we need to process it and consider it and look at it, that doesn't work very well in addressing conflict. You need to address the stress quickly. You need to control your emotions and your behavior. You need to communicate your needs without being threatening, without being frightening or punishing. So that that thought of having self-control and not blurting out exactly what you're thinking or what you feel about this other person is important. You need to pay attention to the feelings being expressed as well as the spoken words. Because like I said, on one slide up, we have all of these strong feelings that are being triggered when there's a conflict. So we need to be aware that there's a conflict not just about the presenting issue, but also about many of these strong feelings as well. And lastly, we need to be respectful of differences. And when we're respectful of differences, we're able to resolve the problem more quickly. So now we'll go back to helpful responses. when there's conflict, this is put out, by the way, by the University of Wisconsin. It was a research-based, evidence-based practice. We want to encourage the other person to share his or her issues as full as possible. So you're going to sit down with the other person and you're going to ask for full disclosure of what's going on. And during that time, you're going to listen. And you're also going to clarify the real issues rather than making assumptions. It's going to be, so am I hearing you right? There's this, my husband speaks Spanish and I speak a little, but he is bilingual. And there's this great expression in Spanish called me explico, which means, did I explain myself? And I use it all the time. Even my kids who don't speak Spanish at all now say, me explico? So it's the responsibility of both the speaker and the listener for there to be communication and understanding. So you can ask yourself, you can ask the other person, did I make myself clear? Did you understand? And you need to ask yourself, did I make myself clear? Is it what I wanted to say? You need to restate what you've heard. So if I heard you right, you said you're concerned about, for example, Mary, whether or not these topics or issues are really biblically founded, and how is it that I am using the Bible in order to inform my discussion as opposed to ignoring it? Did I get that right? And so then in that, I restated what I heard and I asked if I had gotten it right. I checked. Then you want to reflect feelings. And so it seems as though this is an issue you feel really strong about. Like maybe you're not feeling safe in the relationship right now. Validate the concerns of the other person. I can see how you'd feel that way. A lot of people feel that way as well. And expressing appreciation can be a powerful message. That is saying, thank you for bringing that to my attention. Thank you that I had the opportunity to resolve that conflict together with you. All right? So a few tips. Listen for what's being felt as well as what's being said. Make resolution more important than winning or being right. This one's hard. You know, when we're in a conflict and we know we're right and I want that other person to know I'm right, and I'm doing this so that I make sure they know I'm right, I'm going to lose, because I'm going to lose relationship. And if in the end, through the conflict, we lose relationship or we lose a sense of who we are, we've lost. Okay? We're going to focus on the present. All of us have old stuff. In dealing with people who have been remarried, they will run into a conflict and it's related to their first marriage. And so I teach them to say, that's old stuff. And when that comes up, you just need to name it, say, you know what? That's my old stuff. And I need to deal with that myself. That's not yours to deal with. We all have old stuff. I have old stuff related to being in a disengaged family. Some of us have old stuff related to being in an enmeshed family. Some of us have old stuff related to having to stay back a grade in school. And so then you can't imagine putting a child through that same kind of misery. We all have old stuff and we need to recognize that. So what we want to do is focus on the present and not be encumbered by our old stuff. Pick our battles. Not everyone is worth fighting. And so you need to know, both in your individual self, but also in connection with your supervisors at BYA, because they will have battles that you may not feel like fighting, but they will say you need to fight this battle. So you need to not make that decision just individually. Be ready to affirm, forgive, and thank. Be ready. Thank you for your comment. It was very helpful to me. I am grateful that you brought it up. That's thanking, not affirming. You were very brave to bring that comment up. Many people were thinking of it as well. And then also to be able to forgive. And I don't mean forgiving someone for bringing something up. I mean these as individual. That in order to resolve a conflict, forgiveness is going to be necessary. And if you have a really weak forgiveness muscle, you're going to have a very hard time with resolving conflict. And then know when to let something go. You know, there are some issues that are not going to be resolved with the person who created the issue. And I need to practice letting go of that. I process it, I work through it, and I let it go, because it is never going to be worked out with the primary person it's a problem with. That is hard to accept, because we all want resolution. That feels good to us, but it's not always possible. Now, conflict is a particular issue when you're in a position of power. I want to talk a little bit about the love and logic method of both educating and parenting. The love and logic method is put out by Jim and Charles Fay, and I've brought a couple handouts for you. And I'll start with these handouts. Thanks. They need one of each of these. Oh, ma'am, I forgot to keep my own copy. My very best friend is from Mississippi, and every now and then I'll notice her twang coming into my voice, and that's because I'm just remembering her, and it's very sweet. But when I come home from Mississippi, you can't understand a word I'm saying. Did everyone get their handouts? I didn't divide them evenly, did I? There's two handouts. One's two-sided. I was feeling very proud of myself last night while I was printing this, that I figured out how to print on my LaserJet two-sided copies. It's like, ooh. Don't laugh at me. It's not pretty. There we go. Do we about have it? Are you still missing something? So the Love and Logic Institute has put together two different trainings. One is called Parenting with Love and Logic, and the other is 9 Principles of a Love and Logic Classroom. I happen to be certified to teach both of those things, and they come into a lot of the work I do, especially with parents, quite a bit. And it is a way of resolving conflict with your children that is applicable in a classroom. And it the first part of it is that you always lead with love. You always lead with empathy. So your son or daughter comes home from comes home late. Their curfew is 9 o'clock, and they're home at 9:30. And you lead with, "I am so sorry that you came home late. This is really going to be difficult for you, isn't it?" And then follow with, "And you understand that means you are grounded for the next week, because I need to be able to trust you that you'll be home at the time that you're supposed to be home." Now, when Saturday comes and all of her friends are going to the movies, she knows exactly why she can't go to the movies. There is no need for shame or reminders. I don't know about you, but I'm tempted to say, "Well, you know exactly why you can't go to the movies. If you had been home on time," that's a very non-relational way to resolve this conflict. Shame doesn't work. Is there anyone who likes being shamed? I mean, it doesn't feel good. So instead, you approach the child with, "Yeah, this really is awful. You were looking forward to going to this movie, and I am so sorry you can't go." Now, I don't mean in a sarcastic way. I mean genuinely joining with her disappointment that she couldn't go be with her friends. And she then is able to see you not as this difficult person who's trying to make things more uncomfortable in her life, but as someone who understands the difficulties that she experiences. Now, can you see how you could use this when you're sending home one of the parent notes about a missing assignment? I mean, I had kids when I was teaching who would say, Ms. Gray, don't send that home because my stepmother hates me and I'm going to get in so much trouble." And wow, Mark, that's really heavy. You really might get in a lot of trouble, and that's going to be hard. Boy, if that happens, I'm here for you to talk to. I'm happy to talk to you about that, because sometimes processing that helps, because that is really hard. And I'll be praying that your stepmother doesn't overreact and that it goes okay. And here's your notice. I need it signed tomorrow. Well, not tomorrow, the next week. But can you see, I could have said to Mark, "Well, you could have kept your stepmother happy by turning in your homework. You didn't have to deal with this. It didn't have to go this way." And that just shames him. And no one learned anything from shame, anything good. We all learned all sorts of bad things from shame, but no one learned anything good from shame. So instead, I'm leading with my empathy and then following up with my consequences. And that's where the love starts, and then the logic comes behind it. All right? Now, let me see. So we lead with the empathy, we go with the consequences, and then we believe and trust the process that this is going to work out. This is a good kid. He's going to learn a lesson from this, and he's going to remember to do his assignments. these are good parents. We're going to trust that the process works. Okay. Now, maybe you aren't dealing with good parents, and so that might be a place where you have to flex in some way or another. I don't know. I can't say. But I'm talking about generalities. You know, in general, in typical situations, this is what we encounter. So, what we're going to, I have questions and comments in just a minute, but I want to review the things from the Love and Logic Institute. The first one that I have, because like I said, I like to leave my audiences with something to take home, is turning your word to gold. This comes from the nine practices of love and logic in the classroom. It's two-sided, and it gives an effective technique and a love and logic technique. The main thing that makes them define something as an effective technique is that it is enforceable, that it's something you actually have control over. You know, to say, please sit down, I'm going to start now. I don't have any control over whether those kids sit down. I can't make them do that. But if I bring the onus, bring the responsibility on me, and I say, I'll begin as soon as you're seated, then I have control over that, and I can wait until everyone is seated. Coming down a little bit further, keep your hands to yourself. Well, can I really make Maggie keep her hands to herself? Do I have control over that? No, I don't. But I can say, feel free to stay with us as long as you can keep your hands to yourself. And then if she doesn't keep her hands to herself, then she's free to stay in the classroom during PE or however you're going to choose to handle that. Another one, don't be late for class. Instead, all those who arrive on time, go home on time. And there's something we have control over. So that gives you just some pearls of wisdom from Jim Fay's Love and Logic for the Classroom. This next one is my favorite. I learned this love and logic when my kids were in grade school, and they would say, have you been to that parenting program again? You know, because I learned the value of an anticipatory consequence. So it says, so the next time a student does something inappropriate, experiment with saying, oh no, this is so sad. I'm going to have to do something about this, but not now, later. Try not to worry about it. The love and logic anticipatory consequence allows you time to anticipate whose support you might need, how the child might react, and how to make sure that you actually can follow through with the logical consequence. The love and logic technique also allows the child to anticipate or worry about a wide range of possible consequences. Possibly. Possibly. Yeah, I mean, that's a relevant concern. But for me, what will happen, and this happened with me more as a parent than as an educator, because when I was teaching, I didn't know this. I didn't know the right response right then. I didn't know what support I had. I didn't know what consequences I could enforce. I didn't have any idea what to do. I would end up on the phone in my bedroom with my friend who was also learning love and logic and say, okay, you're never going to believe what Thomas just did. And I don't know what to do. And so sometimes I had to sacrifice their learning for that lesson because otherwise I would be administering a consequence that wasn't necessarily the best one. So that is a legitimate concern. But if they've messed up, it's not all bad. They may learn something better by worrying. So the last thing I want to give you, and then I'll open this up for questions, is something I can't find. I am going to be teaching a Parenting the Love and Logic class, the Love and Logic Way class in January through the Biola Counseling Center. It will not be expensive. It's six sessions. It might be $10 a session, something like that. So money should not be an obstacle to keep you or anyone away. Please, So this is just a flyer letting you know it's coming in January 2017, and that I hope that you would consider having some of your parents attend. We'd be delighted to have them. It'll be held up in the professional building where the Biola Counseling Center is. And if you have any questions or comments before that or about that program, please feel free to contact me. The other thing that is on there is my contact information. I know that there will be some questions here that people would rather not ask, you know, in the group and would rather ask individually. And so my phone number and my email address are there, and I am available to you to consult with or talk with. If I can be of any help whatsoever, please feel free to call. All right. So we have about 5 or 10 minutes. I wanted to end with any questions or answers about the material or about something not about the material, however I can be most helpful to you at this time. Yes.
So in looking at some of the enforceable statements for the school, and it says, you know, feel free to stay with us when you can, blah, 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 blah. Because I have had situations where I've had kind of smart alecky kids who would get up and leave my classroom. Do I just allow that then?
Can you read what the unenforceable statement was?
Well, feel free to stay with us when you can keep your hands to yourself.
And what, and the other one was?
Was keep your hands to yourself.
Okay.
Or even, oh, or you are welcome to stay with us as long as you and others are not being bothered.
And so with these kids that are smart alecky and manipulative, I would invite them to sit right next to me. Feel free to sit right next to me until you believe you can keep your hands to yourself.
Awesome. Oh, that's a good one.
And so because they're going to go out, you know, they think going to the principal is great fun. And so you have to come up with a consequence that is going to make them think. And so that's where the value of a delayed consequence is. You know, Stephen, I see that you just can't keep your hands to yourself, and I'm not sure what we're going to do about that, but I promise you I'll come back to you with that, and I'll get back to you by the end of the day. Don't you worry about it. And then I consult with my other Love and Logic teachers and say, Stephen can't keep his hands to himself. What did you do when he was in your class? Okay, over here.
Kind of following up with what she was saying, if you have like a difficult student, when you're approaching them, it seems like some of the Love and Logic techniques, it gives them more of an option rather than saying you don't really have an option, this is what you're going to do. What if they're still choosing not to follow the option that you're giving them a feel free to, because it seems kind of open.
And that is a key principle to the Love and Logic technique, is that we run into trouble with kids when we're trying to force them to do something. And so what we have to do is give them two options, and I can live with either one. So it's like when you've got very young children and you don't open the closet and say, what would you like to wear today? You say, do you want to wear your red shirt or your blue shirt? And they get to choose between the red or the blue shirt. And I have to make sure that I can live comfortably with either one. So don't offer options that you can't live with. So if in the flyer, there's options that it's like, no, I'm not going to do that. Don't use those. You know, you're the teacher. You get to choose. But it really helps to take away the power struggle by giving them two options.
So they feel like they're making.
They're making a choice. Mm-hmm. Yes?
Like this first one of, you know, instead of please sit down, I'm going to start now. I'll begin as soon as you're seated. What if they don't? Or in my case, I said, good morning, when you stop talking. What if they don't? So, yeah. You know, do you never start? You know,
yeah.
How much you let them control?
Right. And there is a measure of practicality here. But there is this thought that, and I concur that when children are given choices and it's not a power relationship, they're more likely to comply with what you want. And so I was thinking that myself, that I could have stood there forever and they would never have. I remember I went to a Catholic school for elementary school, and one time we just went into class and we were all talking. It never occurred to us that Sister Judith wanted to talk, and she was getting angrier and angrier, and she walked around the classroom cleaning our desks, and we just all thought, this is so odd. What we had no idea that she was doing that because she was angry. And so it was obviously a very ineffective way of gathering our attention. And so we have to use ways that communicate what's going on. And perhaps if they're continuing to not want to do or comply with what you're doing, we want to enter more slowly. With something that initially they do want to do, and then it makes its way into the more difficult parts of spelling or something that are less.
I've done high schoolers.
Oh, all right. even more difficult with high schoolers.
That's why I said it's more like to stop talking and get seated. I'll get seated, but it's.
Yeah, and so it may be that that's a statement that's better suited for elementary school students than high school students. Yeah.
How do you deal with the character issue that the parent doesn't want to recognize?
Always. Do I ever deal with a parent issue, a character issue in a child that a parent doesn't want to recognize? And in my experience, an unfortunate battle that I see more commonly today than I did 20 years ago. There is this, my child is perfect, and it feels to me, and if someone sees it different, let me know. It feels to me as if the parent needs that child to be perfect, and that it's more about the parent than it is about whether or not the child is perfect.
Well, just like the things you shared in the first, I'll be overly accommodating.
Right.
We're more worried about how it looks, how it reflects on us. And how,
right,
you know,
right. And so sometimes that conversation as a teacher to a parent needs to go a little deeper with, what's it going to mean to you if Johnny gets a C? And that's a careful balance. But when you've got a parent who consistently can't see their child's deficits, saying, you realize you have your eyes shut, and you're not recognizing at all that Johnny is a royal pain in the neck, that's not going to work. But if we can kind of come in through the back door and say, what's it going to mean to you when Johnny earns a C in my class? Does that help? Okay. Yeah.
Well, I think a good way to communicate that too without sounding too direct and bossy is to say, I need you all to sit down so we can start. Because I think when you express your need, then it makes people feel a little bit obligated. Not always, but you've got to somehow
right.
be direct, but not, you know, if you don't want to say, all right, everyone, sit down. You can say, I need you all to sit down now so we can start.
Excellent. The other thing that I have found is making direct eye contact. So instead of saying, you know, Susie, sit down, it's, Susie, I need you to sit down now, please. And I'm making direct eye contact. And that can be helpful. But I have to admit, when you're teaching high school, it is a whole new ball game in terms of classroom management. So,
one way that works for me, well, you guys don't sign, so that maybe that won't work. But if you maybe start to whisper, one or two people will like, oh, shh, hang on, what'd you say?
Yeah.
I can just start to sign, and they'll, hang on, we're missing something.
Right. You know, you use, as you'll know, in a deaf classroom, is they'll do the lights and get everyone's attention. And sometimes that's helpful too. But I had a college professor do it and we all laughed at her. So, because it's like, really? So.
What works in Awana is they have the five count and they stand to start counting. And it was a big group that works. And I talked to Polly Tagliam with 8,000 kids for Awana Olympics. And all I had to do was one person stands up there and starts counting and they all went quiet.
Right, right. Yeah, if you train them, if you set these things in motion, these procedures in motion, Yeah. Was some over here?
Well, and I think that's exactly correct. It's establishing the priority and the way that you run your classroom. I teach high school from the beginning.
Right.
From day one, this is what I expect. When my students would walk in and knew I was praying, they knew they were late. Sorry. It's just prayer into our lecture. I have an hour.
Right.
1 hour.
1 hour.
You know, there's only so much you can do. So
right.
Establishing that routine daily, they knew exactly that at 8:25 I would be done with prayer.
Right.
You know, and they were going into the lecture or whatever.
Right.
So definitely bringing your expectations as an educator to the forefront on day one, on orientation. Mm-hmm. This is what I expect because I only have this amount of time. Grow up. Especially for high school, sorry. You know, this is it. You guys are thinking about college bound. This is what I expect. In
right.
the classroom.
Right.
And that goes into respect. That goes into respect for one another. It goes into assignments being turned in on time. Welcome to Biola.
And sometimes we get so caught in wanting our students to like us that we have a soft start. And I would highly recommend against a soft start. Start out.
I've actually done the opposite.
Yeah.
I've been extremely harsh at the very
absolutely. Yeah. And there's more flexibility. More flexibility as time goes on. Part of that is because you've developed a trust relationship. And when there's a trust relationship, there's more room for flexibility. Yes, ma'am.
I was just kind of catching on to that because I teach junior high primarily, and so they're really squirrely. But I find that when I just say, first starting the class, you know, oh, I'm so sorry that you guys weren't quiet. I have so much I wanted to do in this class today, and now I may not get to all of it. And it's really, I only have an hour, and it's, you know, we had a lot of fun things. And then I notice that subsequent weeks I don't have to deal with them because they want to have fun.
Right.
You know, all these dumb things I do. So then the other thing is sensitivity, I think, because I tended to be a real, these are the rules and you follow them and I'm going to give you grace at the beginning, but please follow them. And this year really kicked me about that because I had some really families that were struggling with their family dynamic, really heavy stuff. And oh, I didn't know that, and so I tended to say, oh my gosh, he's, you know, my brain, he's flaking, why is he flaking? And you know, when God revealed to me what was going on, then it gave me an opportunity just to really bathe that family in prayer, and to be really sensitive, not to give them a pass, but so we can have our rules and stuff, and we have our expectations, but, you know, these are people mm-hmm. that are having issues sometimes, you know, they're not all robotic and do their, you know, everything correctly, or... and so we just have to really sit back and pray about what's really dictating
what's really going
behavior.
On. Right. And one of the things, when there is chaos in their lives outside of school, by bringing that structure and not imposing ourselves as an authority and saying you can choose from this or this, it gives them a place they can count on at school. I can count on school being safe.
Well, and we've always been, I mean, I go back to Cinda Tribble, love her. But anyway, she always, you know, we're there to really invest and to really be a support for these families and to come alongside, you know, these kids. And that's, that relationship is so crucial for
right.
this program.
Right.
So that's really important.
Relationship's everything, which is why we talked about conflict resolution and we need to resolve it so we can have even healthier relationships. Yeah, I agree with you. Relationship, that's what it all comes down to. So, one more question.
Going off of her, I am very much a people person. I want to make sure that people are okay and I don't care how long it takes. I just need to make sure that you're okay. So in a professional setting, as you know, teacher to student, where is the line between like, you know, I want to take all this time to make sure you're okay, or this is something I can't do, you know, I, you know, suggest, you know, tell them to go somewhere else, or like, what's the line between how much we should be investing in the students?
That's a really good question for you and I to talk about after, because it's a lot more complex than what I could do here. So can we talk afterwards? Okay, good. All right, well, you all know how to reach me. And I've been delighted to be here today, and I thank you for your attention and your kindness.
Biola University prepares Christians to think biblically about everything, from science to business to education and the arts. Learn more at biola.edu.